Whoa, ladies and gentlemen, that is the mug zoom, the first mug zoom, the second mug zoom of 2020.
Two down, lots more to go. Hello.
How's it going, Chris?
It's going very well. It's very well. It's a new year. It's a new me.
Well, you're looking good. You're looking good there.
Well, thanks. I grew this space myself.
Yes. We're all glowing, just so bright and cheery. We've got a great guest with us today. Speaking of glowing, check out Will Thalheimer with us today. The one and only. Good morning, Will.
Good morning, Brent. Great to be here.
Yeah. Maybe for folks who haven't caught up with you before, we'll get you to, Will, just give us the short bio overview of
sure.
yourself.
I've been in the L&D field for over 30 years. The last 21, I've been running my own consulting practice, work learning research. And what I try to do is to take the scientific research on learning, memory, instruction, training, et cetera, and translate that into practical recommendations. And and I share what I've learned in research to practice reports, in workshops and speaking engagements and consulting, et cetera. Mm-hmm. So that's it in a nutshell. I guess the other thing I've focused a lot on in the last 10 years or so on learning evaluation. So not only the science of learning, advocating for that, I'm doing some myth busting as well, but also now focusing on learning evaluation. It's my belief that, it's not my belief, what gets measured gets managed, and sometimes we focus on the wrong things. So I've been focused on that. It's really actually really difficult, the learning evaluation stuff. I sort of feel, even though I'm advocating for some innovations, et cetera, I still feel like a newbie at it. You know, it's really hard to wrap your head around. It's really complicated. So I think we're all learning in that way. Yeah, so I think that's a good introduction.
Yep. And Will's website, if you haven't been there, folks, Lightbulb Joe tossed in the URL for that. Tons and tons of resources that are there. Lots of helpful things for anybody doing stuff in our space. So, and it is, as we've said, a new year and a new us. We've all changed. We the calendar clicked over. We all shed our 2019 skin. We've put that away, and we're now growing our new skin for the year, which led to us thinking, well, what are things that we can do and improve and change and new habits, etc., that we can start bringing forward in our work life. I mean, you know, I'm already going to the gym 5 times a day in the new year.
So you look good.
Woo. Yeah. So my I don't need help in my personal life. It's just my professional life that I need to set some new goals in. So well, there we go.
Why go to the gym? Why not just do it right here in the office?
Perfect. Right at home, everybody.
Right there. Fabulous. Excellent. If you pull out the sword and the shield again in this conversation, then we're totally rocking.
I've got a new prop now.
Oh, there we go.
cutting right to the chase.
There we go. I'm seeing a whole Ginsu knife commercial starting up here now. It'll cut through anything.
Yeah.
It'll cut
if you act now.
Cuts through Addy with just one stroke.
I'm a firm believer in props, you know, because anything that takes the focus away from, you know, this face.
We all suffer from that. We all suffer from that. So, and it makes things memorable too. So
that's right. Hey, you know what? I just want to toss in here real quick, said at the risk of changing the subject too harshly. I think for the whole, as I speak for the industry as a whole, I like to think and just say thank you to you for all of the work that you do with breaking down the research and sharing as much as you do publicly. It's so difficult for us out in the practicing world to get a hold of academic research because a lot of it's behind paywalls and expensive journals and all that kind of stuff. And you've always been so good about sharing and and breaking it down and helping us less academics apply that stuff. So thank you. Thank you. 100%. You've helped us.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Yeah, for sure. Totally. So new year, new us, new L&D. If Will, if you could tell people to change one thing or encourage them, you know, we can't force people. We all know that. Where would we start with a New Year's resolution for L&D?
Wow.
I mean, we can have many things if you want.
I was going to say, that's a big one. Let's well, that's three, maybe. You know,
wow, one thing. You know, I think, you know, the biggest mistake we make when we're designing training is we try to teach too much. I guess I've been advocating this for years, but we still need to remember this. We try to cram too much content. And when we do that, we're not able to provide the learning supports that help us reinforce what's learned. So instead of teaching 100 things, you know, we ought to teach 30 things and then really go into those and provide all the things we know from the research are valuable. So realistic practice, feedback, spacing out of repetitions over time, making sure it's aligned with the context, it's relevant, all those things reinforce. Because if we don't do that, we just teach people stuff and they forget it. So that's you know, that's sort of the main thing. Make sure that you're including the science of learning supports that are valuable. But also another thing is to remain skeptical, right? In all fields, and particularly in our field, we jump from one fad to another. We hang on sanctimoniously to things that don't work that well. I'm a real big believer in the thing from the medical profession, first do no harm. And if we remember that, if we remain skeptical, if we don't automatically, you know, if a vendor tells us, oh, we've got AI and it's great, well, let's be a little bit skeptical and find out, well, do you really have it? And does it really work? Is it useful? Is it worth the cost-benefit trade-off, et cetera? Skepticism is a really valuable thing. So I'll throw out those two things to get started.
Mm-hmm. Skepticism, we have a lot of things that we get taught by osmosis in our business, right? Because so many of us come into this field sideways, we learn from the people around us, we do what we've been, you know, our organization has already been doing, because that's now our job as well. And so there are so many things, and even just our own experiences in education, we all, you know, so many of us, the majority of us, I guess, in the Western world, went to school and it looked like this, and this is how it happened. Someone at the front, the rest of us sitting in rows, and those sorts of things. And that really does form, not unlike, say, you know, you see the political world where people form, you know, have an identity, and facts then sometimes will have to be aligned with that or ignored, etc. But it's a truism in our own space as well. We have an identity that we've formed about what a training thing should be, etc. And letting go of that is a tough thing.
Absolutely, and you see that often. And I just want to emphasize something you say. There's people that flood into our industry every year, and they're brand new. Mm-hmm. And you know, sometimes you know, there's subject matter experts that have to train something, right? And we might give them a 3-day sheep dip. Right, these are how you need to learn, you know, create learning, and you know, that's not good enough, right? Really, we ought to have like a year-long immersion in what to do, so that they're, you know, following the consistent models and recommendations that are out there. We don't do that, and so we got people from all these different perspectives, which is good. It enables us to be more innovative and creative, but at the same time, we don't always have a foundation of common body of wisdom. Mm-hmm. And that's a problem. I see this when I go out and do consulting. I used to go and would make recommendations to teams, right? I'd go in, I do a learning audit, research benchmark it, et cetera, and then I'd share my recommendations. And, you know, because people didn't understand where they were coming from, and I'm fairly good at, you know, making them, you know, understandable, but still, because there's all these different perspectives, people heard the recommendations in different ways, and then the team didn't coalesce around a way to go forward. So now what I do when I make those recommendations is I offer what I call a learning backgrounder, right? Like 90 minutes or 3 hours of background information on the science of learning, the things that work, the things that don't work. And that really gets teams be more aligned. But that's a real problem. You know, we all come from many different backgrounds. Some of us have been focused on learning for a long time. We've got academic background, and some of us are, you know, they were salespeople, but and they were training other salespeople and they're really good at that, and et cetera. So yeah. And Chris, it's funny that all podcasts and video casts now, they're all becoming political. I noticed you mentioned a little bit about the political world. I had to comment on that.
It's a zany world that we live in, that's for sure.
It is a zany world.
It's one of the things that I've run into in the past too, is when you're trying to go in and when you're trying to go in and teach some of those subject matter experts how to be better instructors, that's exceptionally complicated because they think they know everything because they're the subject matter expert, or they've been teaching for so many years, or it's, when I went through medical school, this is how I was taught, and so I can't imagine that anybody else needs it any other way too, and so damn it, this is how I'm going to do it, and I don't need you punk kid coming in here telling me how to teach the colon.
Right. Well, yeah, you know, reminds me of the Dunning-Kruger effect, right? You know, those who...
What is that? Give us a little backgrounder on that.
Oh, well, the Dunning-Kruger effect is simply that those who have, you know, in any field, you know, some of us are more experts than others. And, you know, the three of us, for example, have some expertise, but if we went over into oncology or something, we'd be, you know, rookies, right? So the Dunning-Kruger effect shows that those who have the least knowledge are sometimes the most confident. And, you know, that can be true of us as well, and subject matter experts, as you say. You know, I started teaching an online workshop I call Presentation Science, and I get at this very thing. It's really for people who want to make better presentations, whether they're training presentations or not. And I take sort of a science of learning approach to it. And everybody, when we talk about presentations, well, what's your goal? We want to engage the audience. Well, that's great, and we should do that. But I have a little model. I call it ELRA. So E is for engagement. But we also ought to help people learn, remember, and act. And that sort of opens up, you know, people's eyes to some of these other things that they should be focusing on. And I think, you know, that's one of the big missing opportunities in our field, is the notion of supporting remembering and action. So we can help people remember or understand things. And if I'm a trainer, I look in people's eyes and I can see whether they've got it or not. But I'm going to have a hard time knowing if they're going to be able to remember it, because I'm not going to see them. And when I was a leadership trainer, I would go out and I would teach a program. And at first I wasn't very good at it, but eventually I got pretty good at it. I would get applause at the end and thank yous and all that. But I never saw those people again. I don't know if they remembered what I taught them. I don't know what obstacles they faced. So, you know, that old sort of training as an event model, I'm kind of embarrassed that I was involved in that. And, you know, we got to get beyond that.
We all were, right? Chris, you did training as an event too. I mean, come on, we can all, let's all, you know, I'm a former trainer. Hello, my name is Brent. I'm a former trainer. And
yeah, it's the leaving of the brain dump, and then, you know, nothing after that, which is, of course, an ideal place to actually start doing things like, you know, space learning, et cetera, which is something that Will has done lots of public work on. We do have a question. Sorry, I wanted to scroll back.
And by the way, thank you all for your comments there. Hi, Joe. Appreciate the kind words there, and everybody else is speaking. What's the question?
So Jason in the chat asks, would the mastery in one area help in subject matter mapping in an area that they're not as familiar? And it's an interesting, I'm somewhat parsing the question still myself, so I'll repeat it. Would the mastery in one area help in subject matter mapping in an area that they're not as familiar. And it kind of relates, there's another question in the question panel from Helena. What is your process of conducting a learning audit? And I think maybe there's a bit of potential overlap in those. So my reaction to Jason's is sort of like, well, we do have structures and we do have processes and frameworks and things that we can, may not always be applicable, but things that we can do, for, that patterns and such that we can repeat from one area to another.
Sure, I think maybe Jason's asking, well, maybe we'll just parse the question the way we want to. How's that?
Jason, correct us
if we're wrong. But you know, the subject matter experts, they might be an expert in, you know, how to handle insurance claims or how to do onboarding or how to do whatever, right? But they're not experts in learning. You know, they know some things about learning. They probably know some things that are correct, some things that are incorrect. You know, the things that I've seen work are, first of all, you know, I like to use the learning and forgetting curves, right? Because people go, oh, wow, people learn and, oh, they also forget. And that just makes them think, well, what's my responsibility? What can I do? And then you talk about, well, there's some things you can do to support remembering and minimize forgetting. What are those things? Well, let me give you three of them. And I talk about retrieval practice and context alignment and spacing. And then they go, oh, yeah, I've got to do these things. I'll give you an example. I was working with the Navy SEALs and Special Operations Force, and this was they had a 65-week, this is their original training program, 65-week, that's over a year long for those who are counting. And you know, obviously they didn't want me to do a learning audit because that would have taken a lot of time and cost a lot of money, and my wife would have divorced me, even though San Diego is very nice. But too much time. So what we did was we created a 3-day workshop. And I used the Decisive Dozen, the 12 most important learning factors, a model that I have. And we went down through each of the 12 items. And I was working with Navy SEALs, the instructors who are, you know, experienced Navy SEALs, and their learning architects, their instructional designers, e-learning developers, et cetera. And they were in the classroom. And the commander of the base was there too. And I was very nervous because, you know, this is the first time I'd worked with this audience. So I didn't know how it would go. But basically, we went through each of the learning factors one at a time. I said, okay, this is how retrieval practice works. And then I put blue tape across the wall in one of their classrooms and two lines. Above the top line is, okay, how are what you're doing aligned with the learning right now, aligned with the learning research? Below the bottom line, how are you misaligned? How are you not doing what you should be doing? And in the middle, you know, what are you not sure of, or what are you doing in a mediocre way? And by going through one of these research principles at a time and enabling them to really do the audit themselves, they were the eyes and the ears. And then I would chime in, they'd ask me questions, and I said, nah, that's not quite right, or that's exactly right. But they got buy-in. And they said, okay, we can do this better. We can do this better. And then at the end, we did some action planning. And so that's, I used to call that an immersive learning audit. Now I just call it a learning audit workshop. So that's when they are the eyes and ears. If I do a regular learning audit, I'm still using some taxonomy like the Decisive Dozen. I really like that. I've also used the Learning Maximizers model, which is a little bit different, but you have a rubric, and you basically say, this is what you're doing well, this is what you're not doing so well. But I do like sort of the learning audit workshop idea, because people think for themselves, they bring in their wisdom. Because even as an outsider, I can't possibly see everything that they're doing. They can see that better than I can. So there's some real advantages there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and
go ahead.
I was just going to say that it turns the exercise into one generating intrinsic motivation to change and do different versus thou shalt.
Yeah, the outsider coming in, right? You know,
totally.
That how well does that work?
Especially if you're not part of that culture to begin with. So you're not seen as someone having necessarily, potentially anyway, expertise or knowledge and a level of, let's say, you know, trust to be part of that group. So you're an outsider and therefore, you know, telling people what to do, but switching it over to them generating the change program, it turns it into intrinsic motivation. Very cool. I like that.
Well, and notice we talked earlier about how we've got people from all different backgrounds that come to the field. By doing this sort of workshop, you're getting everybody to talk together. You're sort of getting everybody mm-hmm. to sing from the same sheet of music. You know, whether they're, you know, constructivists or behaviorists or they know nothing or whatever, they come in and go, oh, well, that's how it works. This is what we should be doing. They work in teams. They're deciding what their future is going to be, what they want to work on, and what they want to maintain that's really good. So, you know, they do that together. So it gets the team together. I'm actually surprised. You know, we're learning professionals. We're sort of like the shoemakers. The kids don't have good shoes. We in learning don't often spend time on our own learning. And there's two aspects there, you know, getting some training for ourselves, but also getting feedback from outside source to make sure we can see our blind spots. I don't see us doing that as much as we could be doing. I don't know. What are your thoughts on that? What do you guys see in that?
Mm-hmm.
Well, are we getting the learning that we need? I mean,
it's so hard. I mean, I follow lots of blogs and you're skimming through and you go, oh, that sounds, but then moving from reading a blog, if you even have time to pause past a headline or a couple of paragraphs, moving from that into being able to even spec out time in your schedule to reflect on something, let alone beginning to act on something is a real, it's a definite challenge for sure.
Yeah, I have a hard time keeping my own personal learning structured like that, right? And so I totally get what you're saying. I'm like Chris. I listen to podcasts. I'll scan through some blogs. I can't even honestly say that I read them cover to cover. Most of the time I get the gist. I move on. But I think we're in a mildly different spot because I think learning looks different when you are in a particular, when you're focused in a particular area and you've been doing it for 20, 30, 40 years, you know, and you're at sort of a different place. I think it's very different. I think the hardest thing for us is that remembering what it was like to be new. Right. For me. And that's why I have so much fun talking to those people that you mentioned earlier, too, about that are brand new to the industry. I absolutely love hearing from those folks when they reach out to me and say, I'm new to this. I just got asked to be a trainer a couple years ago and I've been doing it ever since. But I have really no idea what I'm doing. And I'd like to get better at it. Where should I start? You know, that's a question.
What do you tell them? What do you tell? You know,
I say let's start with a phone call because it's like, you know, or at least let's chat or, you know, listen, jump into one of our live streaming collaborative casts like this every week and just kind of ease yourself into it. Start listening to the conversations, listen for the things that you don't understand. We've been dropping some fantastic nuggets in the chat and your website obviously is a wealth of knowledge, but you know, at the end of the day, what I wanted us to get to a little bit today was something tactical. I mean, one of my goals in 2020 is to my word of the year is specific. Sorry to go off on a weird tangent, but, and so I want like everything I do to at least have one level of something very specific and tactical. And we've got some time left this morning. And so I hope we can either do this now or at some point, if we could just dial it down and get tactical with like maybe the forgetting curve or something like that. Like what is something that everybody can do differently? And this relates to the resolution stuff. That is something that they can apply right away to be doing differently to help people with that forgetting curve and to learn. Like we've talked a lot about it, right? We've been very theoretical. What is a good one?
Wow. Well, there's so many. Let's take.
That's why it's hard for me to tell new people what to do first because there's a lot.
It's huge. So, you know, maybe we should simplify it. Okay. Well, so I'm just going to use ELRA, you know, engagement, learning, remembering, and action as a way to wrap our heads around this, because it's too huge to do everything. And obviously you want to do more than ELRA, but let's start there. So engagement, let's start with that. Okay, so how can we engage people better? Well, oftentimes we're using a tool to do our presentations, whether you're online or you're in front of a classroom. We use like bullet points, okay? Now bullet points, we've all seen bullet points for years and years and years, and so they remind us of boredom, right? And they're painful.
The trigger.
So let's get rid of bullet points. And there's ways to do that. Instead of presenting bullet points, we can present things as objects, right? So we can chunk them up. So instead of having a bullet, you have an object. You know, you still have some words there, but you have an object that goes with it. It doesn't look like a bullet point. So that's one way. You can also spread your bullet points across your slides. So if you have 5 items in a bullet point list, instead of doing that, you can have 5 slides going to one of them at a time. There was an old belief that you should have 1 slide and then speak to it for 10 minutes. That's ridiculous. That is bad. It doesn't attach, doesn't align with our human cognitive functioning. So that's one thing for engagement. How's that? So for learning, what can we do to support people in learning? Well, we can use worked examples as one, right? Instead of just showing people examples, we can work, you know, take them through it one thing at a time, break it down, then have them work the whole thing together. That's something useful for learning. You know, most of us are pretty good at engagement and learning, but when it comes to remembering an action, they're harder. So remembering, I'll just give you the 3 things that I think are really important. One is context alignment. So this is the notion that in your learning situation, you should use some of the contextual elements that people will face later in their performance situations. So let me make it simple. It's a context alignment, sounds jargony. You want to simulate, right? You want to simulate as much as possible, give people practice in that. And the second item is retrieval practice. So don't just have people passively listen, have them actually have to retrieve information from memory like they're going to have to do in the real world. And that doesn't mean rote retrieval or, you know, regurgitation. It could be practicing a skill. When you're practicing a skill, you have to remember what you've learned. And the third thing is spacing repetitions out over time. So instead of offering, a full day workshop, you know, break it down into 2 sessions instead and repeat things from one to another. If you don't have that logistical capability, I mean, ideally you might want to space it out over a month or whatever, but you know, we can do that. That's great. But even within a training, even within like a 90-minute online training session, right? I can introduce a topic early on and then repeat it and come back to it, not repeat the exact same thing, but give people practice, have discussions, et cetera. So you repeat it through the 90 minutes. That's a powerful way to support that. And then the final one, action. How can we help people take action? So I'll give you one thing. You know, we all talk about having goals, action plans at the end. Well, those are useful, but they're not good enough. And we should have people, you know, what are the 2 things you want to take away and do something with right away? Okay, great. That's the goal. But we can also use this thing called triggered action planning. And this is the idea that don't just have a goal, but have a specific time, situation, context where you're going to start working on this goal. Okay. So let's say I'm teaching leadership training and I teach about a particular thing. Well, when are you going to use this? Oh, I'm going to use this at my very next staff meeting. I'm going to start to apply this. You know, maybe I'm trying to help people be more creative. I'm going to do a new brainstorming method. Well, when are you going to use this? Oh, at my next staff meeting, I'm going to use it. So the idea here is that if we help people connect to their context, the context will then remind them of what they learned and what they want to do. So that was a long run. So I'm going to let you guys respond to that.
Go ahead with something if you've got in mind, Brent. I'm just going to scan back through the chat because there was a lot going on.
That's great. And that's perfect. That's exactly the kind of tactical stuff I'm looking for. I think folks, to take it down even another level is, to spread out that content, right? Even just making small. This is where technology, I think, is the most valuable for us, not necessarily in the immediate training or the teaching or the instruction, but that after the instruction part, right? Being able to help people practice that recall, right? There's, apps like Duolingo and things like that do that really well in the sense that they'll ping you and say, hey, you know what? You haven't logged in a day. You've probably forgotten a few things. We're going to dial you back and, cue you a little bit to see, if you're remembering this stuff. And, and so they'll give you little tiny cues and they'll just sort of drip it out to you over time. And they kind of manage that spacing process. And I think that's something that we should be much more active in from a technology perspective, but I don't really see it engaged that much. A lot of what we do is still, how can we take the technology and make it still create that one event and then forget it. Let's move on to the next thing and create that event, even if it's a learning course or whatever, right? I mean, I think supporting that long-term learning process is the most important thing we should be using technology for. But that's just me.
I know, absolutely. You're right. I've been reading this book on how to help people develop habits. It's by Wendy Wood. I highly recommend it. I haven't got through the whole thing yet, but highly recommend it. And what she says is, if you want to help people develop a new habit, it can take, like, I think she said the average, and they've looked at this, the average is like 66 days of, yeah. So that's like, how can you
can't repetition, right? This is what we talk about with repetition. You got to do it over and over and over again before it becomes a habit.
Yeah. So think about how we design training. I give a 1 day training on how to champion change, and then there you go. Go off and go do it. And you can set actions. You can do triggered action planning, but that's still not enough. Ideally, you'd have coaching. You'd have a whole focus on it. Maybe you'd buddy up with somebody. But you'd have to integrate it into your, your behavioral repertoire, and just doing it for like a day or two. It's just nuts. It doesn't align with what we know about human cognition. So, a lot of this and I think a lot of this really goes back to what we can get permission to do in our field, because I'm sure a lot of people listening in, watching in now are going, wow. I wish my organization would let me do that. Yeah. I don't know. You guys have been working in the field a long time too. You know any ways that we can, in 2020, in this new year where we're supposed to have perfect vision, is there any way we can get these kind of things to happen?
Yeah, that's the first time I've actually thought of it like that. You're right. What a great way to visualize 2020. It's a clear, perfect vision in 2020. I love that.
I think sometimes things like change are easier if you do them without permission, in the sense that but not necessarily just chucking everything out and saying no, I'm going. But if you can model something different and new, then people can have the picture of it and can see where it's going. We were talking about this in second last episode before the Christmas break, a bit about the make up a small model of something or whatever, so that people can see the thing, as opposed to it just being told, and then they can buy into the potential value for a change, as a way of at least helping people bridge from. Again, it sort of moves you from thou shalt or we shall, and people going, whoa, you're forcing something on me, to, yeah, I'm buying in, and let's do something.
Chris, you've created an explosion on the chat here. People love this idea. So it looks like your audience is filled with people who are champions. They're just going to go out there and do shit. So go do it.
Go do shit, people.
Okay, thank you.
Well, geez, look at the time, everybody.
Guys, break soft stuff, but gentle. Remember that first thing that that Will pointed out. First, do no harm, right? So we're not being reckless in not getting permission or trying to evoke change. We're doing it with a purpose, a value. Have research that help can back you up and guide you, and that you can use that if that has to be part of the conversation. Then give it a try.
And it's just smart too. I think one of the things that I may have brought up the same episode you were talking about was the fact that if you think about this from a different perspective of like venture capitalists, for example, when they're looking at somebody coming to them with an idea and they're looking to give them $1 million to invest in their thing, rarely do they just go, wow, that's a great idea in your head. We're going to just give you some money to go ahead and do it. No, you've got to be pretty far down the road with some sort of prototype thing and be able to show it to them so that they can see it and go, oh, I know what you're trying to do. Now what you're saying matches what you've done and built. We will definitely support that and throw some money at you. And that, you know, I think in certain cases they do give money to people with just ideas, but I think it's an exceptionally rare case from everything I've heard. But so I think from an influential standpoint, that's the kind of thing we need to do. We need to be more rogue in some of these things that we want to try instead of sitting around saying, nobody gives me a seat at the table. You know?
Amy's got a great comment. I think many of us trap ourselves thinking we need someone to say it's okay. But if you change your perspective and mindset to one of experimental or trying something out, then I think that self-prescribed barrier can come down.
And
Christine is asking for us to put it on a mug. So
yeah, let's put it on the mug.
There's a lot of nuggets today that should go on the mug. You know, I don't think we have enough room. We're going to have a collection of different mug sayings, I think.
We need a series of mugs now.
I think that's awesome. Yeah. Yeah, collectors, you know, and then maybe you could, restrict some of them, and so they'll become like collector's items, right?
Oh, now you're talking. Yeah. I think Amy's comment is a great place for us to start wrapping this up today. What do you say, Chris?
I think so. Will, thanks so much, as always, for joining us. Lots of great, I don't know, we always end up going in so many directions, but it's always so valuable, all of those directions. And we really do appreciate you taking time and joining us this morning and helping us start the new year off in a great way.
Well, I am delighted to help you look toward 2020 with, some real benefits.
Yeah, definitely. We'll get a mug in the mail for you.
Thank you, guys. It's a great pleasure.
Check out his website.
Thanks everybody for joining us today, and let's have a dance out before we forget.
Let's do it. Let me do a pitch for next week's episode too. We got Kevin Thorne coming back on for a repeat drink and draw. If you guys missed drink and draw last time with Kevin Thorne, that was a ton of fun. We're gonna do it again. So drink some coffee and learn how to draw and sketch and be a better instructional designer with Kevin next week. So sign up, click that save your spot button. And we'll see you guys next week. Let's dance.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks again, Will.
Thank you, guys. Great fun.
With the Zoom.